It's a great pleasure to introduce those of you who don't yet know her to Professor Patricia Kingori, another great friend of all of us here at BSMS and the University of Sussex. Patricia is a sociologist, and being based at the Ethos Centre in Oxford, she has been unable to avoid a considerable amount of bioethics through her career. And we also particularly value Patricia's global perspective, both as a sociologist and now as a bioethicist. So over to you, Patricia.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here, and thank you so much for inviting me. I have to admit, I've been a tiny bit nervous to present this because it's the first time I'm kind of bringing this to an audience, and also bringing in an AMR angle, which I'm less confident about. But what I'm really hoping to do, following in from the really great example that Pete set, is to sort of stimulate discussion and thought on this. So the idea would be to just to give you an overview of the project I've been working on for the past 3 years. It's a four-year project. Then talk a little bit more about substandard medicines, and then questions around who gets them and some of the ethical issues. And all of this would be discussing AMR throughout. Thank you. So showing the sort of, quickly showing the limits of what I'm capable of, and also time this just to make sure that I don't get on the wrong side of Bobby. So the project is a four-year project, and what I really wanted to do was really ask questions around who gets to say that something is fake. Most of my work, I realised, and retrospectively, is really questions around power and who gets to ask these questions and answer them and what directions they point us to. So, I mean, I could have really looked at lots and lots of different things, but in the interest of feasibility, I really focused on two areas: knowledge production and medicines, drugs and medicines. And so because of today's discussion, I'm going to really focus on the second of this, which is looking at drugs and medicines and some of the issues around fakes, fabrications and falses in that. But in the questions, I'm happy to answer anything about any area of this. So I wanted to also talk about some of the people on my team. So this is Kate Enright and her project. She's doing a PhD, which is really looking around, and she's fascinating. She's a pharmacist, worked in the army. She's really interested in questions around availability and quality of medicines in global health, and how people on the front line really navigate questions around ethics. And another PhD student on the project is looking at frontline workers' ethical issues in relation to the quality of medicines and maternal health. And so this work by Scholastica Zakayo is looking at this issue specifically in Kenya. I also wanted to talk about another piece of work that's part of this project, which is a collaboration between myself, Koen Peters at the Institute of Medicine in Antwerp, Institute of Tropical Medicine in Antwerp, Rene Garetz in Amsterdam. It's a whole team of people, including Rachel Douglas-Jones in Copenhagen, when we were working really closely with the Institute of Magic at Goldsmiths, really trying to understand this question around misdirection and fakery. So we were fortunate enough to be able to put together a special issue in science and technology studies, where we really focused on this idea of misdirection in global health. What we were interested in, drawing on the psychology of magic, was the ways in which we're all told to look in a particular direction at one thing when something else is happening elsewhere. And the idea is that we're all directed to, in the same way that a magician, a central part of magic, is to focus your audience attention on one thing when something else is going on. We really wanted to use this idea in a creative sense, conceptually, and bring it into our discussions around global health. So my contribution to the special issue was really exploring this idea of fakes as a misdirection. I wanted to bring some of that thinking to this discussion around fake medicines and AMR. And one of the things that we were I was really keen to do was really to talk about the emphasis on fake medicines and how actually we have so much emphasis on fake medicines that we spend very little time looking at substandard medicines. There's a really important difference between fakes and substandards. Fakes focusing much more on intentionality. So the fakes are these sort of nefarious, ill-motivated, by design to harm. Substandards always seem to be something that's kind of much more incidental, something that has happened. And I really wanted to question that. And also the way that we have, for example, massive campaigns around fight the fakes and hardly any emphasis on actually substandard medicines. So I would really recommend this, especially if you're not fighting in it. But actually, it was a really fun thing to do and really interdisciplinary. And the Institute of Magic were fantastic and really helping us push our thinking. So with that, really started to think a lot more around the quality of medicines and actually how do we think about the things that are much more boring and mundane. In a way, thinking about fakes really takes us into a world of these sort of nefarious bad guys and really helps us to see global health almost in this sort of Marvel Comics, caricature version of itself. Whereas the substandard version really takes us to really things like transportation and storage, which are seen to be much more mundane versions of global health, but I would argue far more important and actually far more prevalent. So when we think about the more boring elements, I would argue actually part of the more interesting, but things like substandard medicines, it really takes us into thinking about the quality of medicines. And in particular, the active pharmaceutical ingredients of these medicines. And how this relates to antimicrobial resistance, antimicrobial medicines. So one of the focus of the work has been really to try and think about what is this relationship between the way that medicines are kept and stored, how does this then affect the actual active pharmaceutical ingredients of those medicines, and then what's the relationship between that and AMR, and how do we think about that? Because actually, what we often think about are, well, we don't often think about the relationship between quality of medicines and AMR. When we do, we focus on much more the fakes version and not actually the substandard versions. So together with a team of sociologists, pharmacologists, all sorts of other people, we really started to think of, to put together a pilot study to really look at this on the ground. And I want to, at this point, to show a recognition to Professor Pierre Cumbia, who is 2 years since he passed away, but he was one of the key people we were involved in, who were really thinking about focusing on substandards. And actually, it really then shifts our attention to thinking about what matters to people on the ground, and really then the kind of ethical issues that emerge for people on the ground. So, what we did was we designed a project where we had objective and external sources of information to give us confidence that those medicines were authentic. And that was really important. And then what we wanted to do was to follow those medicines from the ports to the points in which they were being dispensed to see the depreciation of the active product ingredients over time. This hasn't actually ever really genuinely been done with social scientists before, but we were trying to ask these kind of questions. We wanted to follow 2 medicines for different reasons, one of which was an antibiotic. The other one was really key in, has been really seen as a solution, at least by the WHO, in maternal health. So oxytocin is a thing that's given to women when they're experiencing postpartum hemorrhage. Postpartum hemorrhage is still the number one reason that most women in the global south die. So we wanted to have a look at 2 locations where there's high quality, well, they're being given external validations of high quality of medicines, where these medicines are in high supply, and follow them to see actually what happens to those in the final mile. So the idea is not necessarily to look at these places in capital cities, but to look at them in rural areas and to see actually what happens to those medicines when they leave, and what can that actually tell us about the way we even think about counting and quality of medicines. Because often when people look and do surveys around quality of medicines, and even with AMR, they tend to focus on the places that's easiest, the first mile, right? Mm-hmm. And then after that, we don't really pay much attention. What we know is that most medicines in these locations are imported from elsewhere. So looking at what actually arrives into those countries is really important. And sampling that, looking at things like temperature logs, we know that we chose both of these medicines because they both have very strict regulations on how they're supposed to travel, neither of which are particularly designed with the Global South in mind. So they have actually very particular temperature they're supposed to be kept at. We were attracted to this because it then tells us that there's all sorts of infrastructure that's needed to keep those medicines at their kind of optimal conditions. And so then we follow them into clinics and into different locations, into pharmacists. So these are just some of the places that we looked at, different venues. We wanted to track them as well. We also wanted to look at, for example, how much light they were exposed to, because again, these are medicines that are designed for the global north, so they're not supposed to be kept in certain temperatures. What we know is that, for example, with oxytocin and amoxiclav, they're part of, in many locations, the kind of pregnancy delivery kits that women are told by their doctors to buy and keep these medicines before they go to hospital in case there's a stock out. Now, while this is really important advice, because this could essentially save these women's lives, these are not medicines that are not supposed to be, are supposed to be kept in people's homes, sometimes in the light, outside of fridges. So we start to see the way that two things are happening here. It's compromising the active product ingredients of those medicines, and then it's also potentially exposing those medicines to AMR. It's still not entirely clear what the relationship is actually between substandard and phosphide medicines and AMR. And I think this is a kind of, so this is the paper that came out this year, where they did a kind of systematic review. And this to me is a kind of a huge misdirection, that actually there is not even enough emphasis or data really collected on the relationship between these things. But we know that, for example, that a lot of, 17.4% of the medicines that they looked at, the antibiotic medicines, were substandard and falsified. So we know that there is an issue, particularly in low and middle income countries. But there's a lack of evidence really for us to think about these two things together. And so I suppose part of this talk is really to open this up and to really explore, if we recognize this as an issue, why then is there not enough emphasis on this? I was really interested in the focus of the conference and the workshop, which is really looking at marginalized populations and bringing this in again and looking at this in relation to low and middle income context, but also looking at the stakes involved when we're thinking about, for example, this particular area of maternal health. One of the reasons why I was particularly attracted to this area is because actually it's one of the rare areas of global health where there's actually a solution. Women are dying, most of it's from postpartum hemorrhaging. There's a drug that's available. Why is that not working? So there is actually a very kind of potentially lovely narrative around this, and yet still, and this is a medicine that's in wide supply, yet still, why are we in this situation? And so it really allows us to really think through, especially with this idea around misdirection, who gets the attention, and what are we not looking at when we're focusing on one thing, on one area, when we should actually be looking at something else. So I just wanted to leave with just a couple of ethical issues that this poses. One of them is really, and again, there are many, but I wanted to just leave with a couple. So should frontline workers in receipt of these antibiotics use this medicine? And this isn't just about the locations that we've looked at. We know, for example, that in lots of locations in the global south, we've seen this, especially in humanitarian crises, people just be given massive bags of boxes and things, shipping containers with antibiotics in them, and the population that needs antibiotics. Sometimes those antibiotics, they could be in a shipping container for 2 weeks, then they travel for 3-4 days to a clinic in a truck, at the back of a truck, and then they're kept in the clinic with irregular supplies of electricity. And so you're starting to see what's happening here. And for people who are very, very careful and really want to think carefully about AMR or even the quality of the medicines, the question is, what should they do with this? Should they use it or not? And I've had interviews with frontline workers who have, for example, destroyed medicines, and it's actually incredibly expensive and ecologically damaging to destroy medicines. Would destroy medicines because they felt there's no way this medicine's any good. And that's not because they have concerns around fate. It's because they know it's been sweating away in a shipping container and is far from optimal conditions. So should they use them? The destroyed medicines, which have actually turned out to be okay. And at the other time, used medicines, which have turned out to be really poor quality. And so this is a kind of a dilemma and a blind spot in global health that we're really not really taking seriously. And it really demonstrates to us the way that, I mean, and Marsha talked about this in her talk, the way that our focus is still so top down and so focused on counting certain metrics that we're not looking at other things or other voices. And again, the question is, who should be responsible for the transportation and storage of medicines in global health? This is a really big question, right? And something that I'm learning about, I just took it as a given, I think, like lots of people, that if somebody gives a donation of medicines, then they're responsible for getting it to people safely. But actually, those two things are completely uncoupled at the moment. And lots of funders, for example, will not fund the infrastructure of a clinic to ensure that the fridges work or to ensure that there are even field level tests available to help give people confidence that the medicines that they're giving are safe. So there's a whole question around the infrastructure of global health that's completely missing when all we focus on is how many vaccines we distribute or how many medicines or pills we give. We can count those, we can track those, but there's very little emphasis on who should be paying for how these medicines are given. And actually, the way sometimes it works is kind of perverse in the sense that if I make a donation of medicines, I can essentially indebt the person receiving it because they then have the responsibility of keeping that medicine safe and the infrastructure that costs. So I think there are all sorts of questions around this. And one of the things I've been thinking through is the ethics of even posing this issue, because really thinking about what Pete was saying, there are definitely people who see global health as a luxury and things and something that is so complicated, it almost should just be left for the individual nation states to deal with. This is an issue that I think if people, you know, one of the arguments can be, if we're not sure about the quality of these medicines and if they're contributing to AMR, should we be giving them in the first place? And is this then a way to stop people from getting medicines and care that they need? So I think this is a sort of the space for us to maybe think about some of these things. But what I wanted to do in this talk was really to draw our attention to another area, the ways in which actually, when we're talking about medicine quality and we talk about fakes, we're missing another area, which is actually the infrastructure of global health and how we can sometimes, through lack of thought and lack of care, be contributing to making people even more vulnerable in that process. So I'm going to stop there. I hope I've stayed on the right side of the box.